100% money back guarantee makes us stand apart in the league, making us the leader. SimplyLearn.com, the industry leader in online education and training for professional certification courses.
Mr. Raja Bhavani, Chief Architect of Mindtree. He's going to have a session, is software architecture still relevant in Agile? A little bit of brief about Raja. He's the Chief Architect of Mindtree Product Engineering Services, PES and IT Services Groups and Place, and plays in the role of an Agile evangelist. He has more than 2 decades of experience in the IT industry. He has published papers at international conferences on topics related to code quality, distributed Agile, customer value management, and software estimations. Raja holds a master's degree in electronics from the Bharathidasan University and pursued a postgraduate diploma in computer science and applications. He is a member of the IEEE Computer Society. He regularly interfaces with educational institutions to offer guest lectures and writes for technical conferences. He writes for magazines such as Agile Record, Cultural IT Journal, and SG Times. Please welcome Raja Bhavani.
Let us do some reorg. So there are some empty chairs. Feel free to come forward so that come on. Get engaged. Occupy the 3 chairs. There are 2, 3, 4. Yeah. As many of you come, it's going to help us. So now I want to pick people and move them. On the topic title of the slide itself, the session title was, is architecture still relevant in Agile? The answer is, of course, yes. So there's no meaning debating about that. So rather, we get into something which is going to help us understand that subject a little more, right? So what I do is I go around, talk to people, deliver these sessions, write blogs, and the most interesting part is when people come to me and ask some conflicting questions, share their experiences, and participate in discussions. And that's what I expect today. So I want you to be engaged, I want you to ask questions, and in many forums like this, we'll have one or two people who have the curiosity. The curiosity is, will you share the PPT at the end of the presentation? Right? Will you share the PPT at the end of the session? The answer is yes. If you want the PPT, you write a mail to me, I can send it to you. But in order to benefit all of you, what I have done is, I have put the whole thing as a 4-part blog series in my blog post. So whatever we are going to talk today, it's all match fixed. It's all stage managed. And I have thought through it, and all that has been articulated in a 4-part blog, and it has been posted on the internet. So when you go home, you go and search on the internet on my name, or at the end of the session, I'll tell you the URL of my blog, go through it, read it, and participate in a discussion. So with that note, it's a fine morning. The traffic was not that bad today. And it's good to have all of you here. I know all of you play a significant role in your organizations.
Hello, check, hello, my testing, check, hello.
So if you have any questions, we can have a round of discussion around your questions at the end of this session. So what I'm going to cover today is with certain assumptions. One assumption is that yes, we know the basics of agile and architecture. So I'm not going to go deep into agile manifesto, agile principles, etc. And of course, if you're new to agile, if you're going to attend training programs, you're going to go through all those. And I assume that yes, all of us know what agile is. We know a basic definition of what it is all about. And expectations are, one is mobile phone in silent mode. And to me, mobile phone in silent mode is take your mobile, put it in mute, and after putting it in mute, take it like this and put it inverted on your desk. So the screen is not flashing on. But there is a SMS or call delivered, your attention does not go there. Otherwise, if you have some emergency situation at home, if you are expecting something, you have to be on phone, keep it closer. Keep it in a vibrate mode and keep it closer. And feel free to ask questions. Okay? And this is what I plan to cover today. We will just get into the word, the term architecture, talk about what software architecture is all about and what is the role of an architect and what do we expect from architects. And what kind of role these terms play in software life cycle? We do architecture, we do design, and what kind of role these things play? And there are two different schools of thought. One is architecture thinking, another is agile thinking. How do these vary from each other? And architects and designers, to be or not, should they be in the world or should they just do something else? And then what kind of value add they can bring to the table? Is there a value add in that role? And how does it relate to agile methods? So that's what we are going to cover today. And I want to start the whole thing in a very lighter note. So another hand raising exercise. How many of you recognize this building? One, two, three. I think everyone should raise your hand. This is Shaniwar Wada in Pune. So Shaniwar Wada in Pune, when you go and stand in front of a monument like this, what comes to your mind? So some thoughts, some words. Because you're all software engineers, right? You're soft IT professionals. As an IT professional, you go and stand in front of a building like this. Several terms come to your mind. Some people think, oh, what a bright architecture. And what a solid design. And then slowly you start focusing on certain elements that attract your eyes. So the elements may be those slim rectangular wedges or gaps which are designed so that if enemies are going to attack you, you can direct your arrows through that. The enemy will not see you, but an arrow is going to pop through that and it's going to hit the enemy. And there are certain holes on top, you can see the window-like big holes. Those are meant to pour hot liquid on people. If enemies are going to come and stand and try to bang on the door, they're not going to do it in a comfortable way. We are going to pour hot water or hot liquid on them. So every element has a purpose. So what you do is you slowly start observing certain sections and say, what is this? Why is this built? You want to know more and more about it. And later you look at the door. The door is about 21 feet high. That's what they say. A 21 feet high door. Because an elephant must be able to get into the door. So this door is not for just for human beings. And if the enemy is going to attack with these elephants, then the elephants are going to come and bang with their heads on the door. They should not be able to bang their head because in order to do that, there are iron spikes on the door. So the iron spikes are meant to deter elephants from enemies. These elephants may come and hit on the door, bang on the door. And like this, you keep on observing and go to the backyard and see the race. The whole thing has been
done with some planning in mind. There are some internal elements, there's a courtyard, there are rooms, there are places to stay, and so on. There are multiple gates. And you understand that every element in this architecture, in this building, has a purpose. And then you say, hey, I'm working on this project, I'm spending so many hours, day in and day out. I don't know what this architecture is all about. Why don't we do cool things like this in IT world? So what is different in our world? So in many conferences, many speaking sessions like this, it is very easy to compare civil engineering and software engineering. But we should not go deep in such comparisons. So because those comparisons are going to misguide us. These two are different fields. One is a highly mature discipline. Another one is a new discipline. It's maturing. And there are so many other differences. However, if you look at and treat these sources as alternate sources to learn from, definitely we can have some takeaways. You can ask questions such as, do you think those days, 1800s or late 1700s, there was an architect who had an architectural vision of Shanivarwar, who created the vision, conducted a meeting and told that, hey, this is how the architecture vision of Shanivarwada is going to be. Now my phase is over. I'm going to go to Delhi because they are building a new fort there. I'm going to play the role of an architect. So my part is over. I have given you the architecture vision. I have given you some diagrams. I have given you some guidelines. And I am out of this phase. And I'm going into a new project. So what do you think he must have done? Nobody knows. We should go and do some research. Or do you think that he must have stayed with his team throughout the construction and he must have had an open mind to collect ideas from them and implement those into the architecture so that when it is done and delivered, it has a better purpose. So these are some of the things we can definitely think about and go with certain takeaways from sources. Okay, let us move on. Our world is different, our world is dynamic. So when you're doing a project, you have to change the platform. A new version of the OS is released. A new version of the database is released. So you have to upgrade. You have compatibility issues. And you have to make sure that your product is going to be released in another country or geography, so it should comply that language, etc., etc. So our world is dynamic, and our world is different. And in our world, from A to Z, you will find these terms. There are so many types of architectures. There is application architecture, and someone says business architecture. And do you guess anything for C? And D for data architecture. Enterprise architecture, hardware architecture, information, network, performance, security, and whatnot. There are so many buzzwords, and everything has a meaning. It's not that somebody just holds on to something and lives his life happily ever after. And we have n number of architectures. And in spite of these, we have adequate amount of fuzziness in what we do and what we deliver. So now our focus of this session is going to be software architecture. What is software architecture? What do we mean by software architecture? So when we understand this, we'll be able to tell how it works in evolutionary methods or agile methods and how it should work. So typically, architecture talks about the different components of the structure of the system and how these modules or components are interrelated and what are the interfaces, what are the external systems, and what are the performance, scalability, reliability, and all these requirements, and what are the guidelines that the development team should follow in order to implement the system. So that is one definition. So you need not write it down. All these are there on the web. And it is all about making significant decisions. certain decisions which are required to be made at early stage, certain decisions that are going to help the team in doing the development, and talking about the structural elements, interfaces, their behavior, how they are composed, and how these components are going to relate to each other and make a system as a whole. In addition to that, if you see the last paragraph, this is not only about the structure and behavior. It is not, you don't just do a block diagram, which is the structure. You have to define the behavior also. That is, you use diagrams like sequence diagrams, show the behavior. It is not just about those static and dynamic diagrams. It's more than that. Usage, functionality, performance, and reuse. Economics, how much money you're going to spend, whatever architecture you have defined, is that going to assure you that you will complete the project within budget? Very important. You cannot assume that you have unlimited budget and define an architecture. So this is another definition. So going by this definition, if you just step back and relate or think about the various types of architecture you have worked with, in your career. I think all of you must have at least 10 plus years of experience. So we come across the lowermost type, who is a PowerPoint architect. So this is a person who is passionate about creating PowerPoints, block diagrams, and say that, hey, this is the architecture. And his goal is, he'll go to the management team, he'll explain the whole thing, present the whole thing. Now he'll say, hey, now my activities are done. The architecture is ready, the designers and developers are going to develop it. And the second person is a relay sport architect who believes that his role is the superior role. He creates an architecture either in the form of a block diagram or a small word document. He will hand it over to the team and say that now the architecture phase is over, I am moving into the next project. So he hands off. And the next one is a part-time architect. He's an architect who has elevated himself in the organization. At any point of time, he works on 3 or 4 projects. And he will spend just a day or two, not more than that. And he thinks that he has the capability to deliver an architecture. He will be called when there is a proposal made. He will be called when a project is starting. And sometimes he may be called when a project is under fire. So he's a part-time guy. So he's very good in finding faults. He's very good in talking about things and giving high-level suggestions. And the next cadre is glorified coder. So there is a coder. There is a programmer who is very good, performing very well, but he has this ambition of becoming an architect. He is behind his manager, he always follows up and says, you know what, when will I get my promotion? Then what do you want to become? You will become a project manager very soon, don't worry. No, I want to become an architect. And this guy thinks, oh, if I don't make him an architect, he's going to resign. So let me better make him an architect. So he's a glorified coder, he has been given the title. He's passionate about things, he wants to learn, but he doesn't know the ins and outs. And the other category is, a project manager who failed in many projects. And people find that, hey, he's not a project manager material, but he knows technology. So we should make use of his skills, and probably he can be an architect. So the organization decides and says, okay, let us make him an architect. Let us call him an architect. And the ground reality is that he miserably failed in the role of a project manager. For that reason, the organization has pushed him into the role of. And finally, you have the been there and done that type of architects. So those are the real experts who have done that, who have been in several projects, who have played that role, who have stayed with the team until the project was delivered, and who have seen the ups and downs. So they know the ground realities. So that is the real picture of what is happening in our industry. We have seen architects under these 5 or 6 categories. And you can come up with more categories also based on your experience. The being there and done that architects are very hard to find. Sometimes organizations try to categorize them as introverts. They don't go and mingle with people, but they are very hardcore techie guys. I want him to do only architecture, but he does coding also. That's what I don't like. That's how they come. But an ideal architect must be able to do both. He's a great team player, a great coach. So what do we expect? We expect all this. Experience is required. And in addition to that, an architect must be a humble person. He must always think that there is a scope to improve, learn new things. He must know how to design, use tools. He must be a developer as well. He must be able to code. Coding is very important. And mentoring and coaching, working with a team and creating multiple designers and architects inside a project is very, very important. And he has to be a true leader. A true leader is someone who can influence people, who can negotiate, who can present his recommendations to the stakeholders, who can work with the management and make them trust or make them believe how a project is going to succeed because of certain architecture decisions. So these qualities are very much required. So when we talk about architecture, all these points are very, very important. We cannot ignore them. So after knowing all this, we have to ask a question, do we need architects and designers in certain kind of projects? Or when we apply certain kinds of methods or methodologies, what is the role of an architecture? What is the role of a designer? So when this question comes, the first thing I would ask is, what do you mean by an architect? What do you mean by a designer? So that is why I put these slides to set the context that the role of an architect is not to create a block diagram. The role of an architect is not to create a PowerPoint or an architecture document. It is more than that. Because when you try to create a PowerPoint presentation or an architecture document, what are you doing? You are trying to define the architecture. So defining the architecture is one part. Another part is implementing the architecture. If you are good at defining the architecture, who is going to implement the subsystems? Who is going to implement the framework? Yes, Vishal.
So, would it be appropriate to assume that in agile environments, actually the kind of architect that you need is mostly like a coder type of person, simply because you don't have enough liberty of mentoring, coaching, leading, and all that? Is that a safe assumption, or should I wait for you?
Yes. Yeah, definitely, yes. Because agile is all about working as a team and not taking position. So taking position is bureaucracy. So taking positions has not helped in any teams. Volunteering, becoming a role model, becoming a coach, becoming an influential person. That is important. See, whoever takes a position doesn't become an influential person. If a CEO keeps on believing, you know what, I'm the CEO. As a CEO, I'm doing this. So he loses his influence. Those who get on the ground and work with people in influence, they make the difference. They come to them. So going by all these concepts, I want to ask a very critical question. When you release a product, when you release an application in production, it is in the hands of the production support people, sustenance team, or the consulting team. Consulting team goes around, implements, upgrades, and all this. So do they ever feel the value of an architect or designer? What do they use again and again? When there is a bug, when you're debugging something, and when you're doing customization, in most cases, they wade through hundreds of lines of code. Try to understand the code, try to understand the design, try to understand the architecture, then make a fix. So what kind of impact an architecture or design creating on the post-production release phases or activities? Practically nothing. All of you close your eyes and assume that you are going to fix a very difficult bug. And you have a facility by which you are able to get a map of the entire architecture and zero down to which module you need to go and fix the bug. Wouldn't it be a gift to you? It would be a gift, isn't it? So, in practice, what happens is you have an outdated architecture document, you have an outdated design document, and you have production code. So those who spend time in reading the architecture and document, design document, they get disappointed because the code talks over something else. And finally, as part of production support team or sustenance team or consulting team, what you do is you go through code, you try to understand it. So then my question is, what value do architects and designers add? Or how do they intend to add some quality to the work life of these people who are involved in production support, sustenance, or consulting activities? We have not seen that happen, but there are a lot of people who are thinking about it, who are researching and telling that there should be some way of doing it. At least you specify a module name, you specify a functional name. The system should tell people that you have to take these classes and start looking at these classes. You have to start looking at this layer in the architecture. And we have Google Maps. We have so many sophisticated applications on our smartphone. And as soon as you get into your work, that world is a dumb world. It's not an intelligent world. People are frustrated. So traditional approaches have left us here with this question. We have not seen any benefit in this area. Okay? Now, what is agility all about? The agility is nothing but our ability to create and respond to changes. And live in a world where the business environment is turbulent. You cannot draft requirements for a product which you want to deliver after a year. You should be dynamic in understanding the market, and you must be able to change according to what the market expects. And adaptability is important. People are important than the processes. And collaboration is important. And Agile believes in a barely sufficient methodology. It doesn't go in textbook. What we do matters rather than what is written in the textbook. And to put it in simple terms, when you practice Agile, you come across terms like this. Deliver early, deliver frequently in short intervals. Do that in sustainable pace. You must be able to sustain the pace. If you're delivering every 2 weeks or every 3 weeks over 6 months or 12 months, you must be able to sustain that. The team should not burn out. There should be work-life balance. And deliver what values to the business, what matters to the business. You should have self-enabled teams. Customer collaboration is important, responding to change, and fail early. Understand the risks, try to fail early so that you can recover, you can understand what happened, you can improve. And working code is the true measure of progress. It's not that you create an architecture document or design document and your project manager reports that the project is completed by 25%. So that is not the true measure of completing documents and updating the project status is not the true measure of progress in our world. So there are two schools of thoughts. One is architecture thing, what we have seen in traditional world. There is an architect who thinks, you know what, I am an expert. I hold the cool title in this company. I'm a VP or I'm a general manager or someone who is above all of you. I will decide what to do. I've heard so many years of experience. Big upfront design is what I do. I understand all the requirements. I draw specification of all designs. And architecture is a very complex entity. I'm autonomous. I make my decisions. Coding is what I used to do several years ago, but I'm very busy these. I'm too busy. I'm up in the hierarchy. I've done a lot of coding, but I don't even get time to review your code. Okay. okay, I only two or three hours per day, I'll come and sit in meetings, I give some suggestions, I move on. Versus agile thinking is, we do just enough architecture activities. We always stay together as a team. We don't do big upfront design, because big upfront design has disadvantages. It makes the system very rigid, because it makes a certain decisions. You make too many decisions and you don't want to move. You don't want to change those decisions. And later on, you end up wasting time in changing certain components that you've built. So it's good to do just enough design. And always agile people feel that, I know, I work with you. You learn from me. I am your mentor. We believe in emerging architecture and design. We understand the overall purpose of what we are going to do. We develop the architecture and design in bits and pieces, and implement, demonstrate the feature, get feedback, and move forward. This is because we want to accommodate changes in a cost-effective manner or in a cheap manner. Whenever there is a change, we must be able to accommodate change without making a lot of modifications. And for this, we will work as a team to evolve the right architectural design. We will provide the right diagrams and documents as and when necessary. We are not going to give documents that never get updated. When the project is at the logical end, we will design. If an architecture document or design document or a cool feature that I told you about is going to help the team. If that is what is going to help the team, we will deliver it to them. Maybe a production support guy comes and types in few keywords, and my system, my documentation repository is going to give him or direct him towards the right interface, right layer, right component. And it's going to make his life better. So these two schools of thoughts are totally different. And we have seen a lot of success in Agile. Agile is the happening thing. Agile methods are successful. Many companies are adopting Agile, which means that those who live with architecture thinking, they need to change their mindset. And they have to come into the school of Agile. Okay? They have to come. They have to believe that architecture can emerge. They have to believe that there is no big upfront design. They have to believe that architecture is not a phase-wise activity. There's no architecture phase, but it continues throughout the life cycle. They have to believe that they have a role to play in making the team better and better. So when you don't have those things in your mind, you always get frustrated and ask this question. Architecture designers, do we or not? So what do we do with these guys? We call them as architects, we call them as designers. Now we are going to start a scrum project in my company where there is a scrum master and the team members. So how do we put these architects and designers in this team? So to be or not to be is your job. Are you going to have the job title? Are these titles going to disappear? And they are not dead. We need architects and designers. And they must understand what Agile talks about. They must understand the principles of Agile. And they must believe that they can add value to a project. So then the question is, how can they add value? I think I talked about some of those elderly. How can they add value? They can add value in many ways. They can do architectural planning along with the team. So the team understands the overall picture of the architecture and gets the vision on what the architecture is all about. I can tell you there are agile teams, and those teams do not have a clue about the vision of the architecture. They keep doing what is told on them. They keep doing whatever stories come on. Architecture-driven approach is the way to understand technical risks. There is no other way. You have to implement certain end-to-end features. You have to implement those features with the right kind of data, production-like data. That is when you can identify certain risks and fix. Otherwise, you build the entire system, it moves in production, then you come across certain issues. And forward vision and roadmap enables team members. when the team members know that there is a person who draws the roadmap, who knows what is going to happen in this project over the next 2 or 3 months, they feel happy about it. That enables them. And it creates a learning environment. When an architect sits with the team members, they learn architecture, they learn designs, they learn how to write beautiful code. And architects and designers can become role models in their team and demonstrate the values of Agile Manifesto. But unfortunately, what happens in our industry is we have a mad rush. And that is a phenomenon called the window seat. Everybody wants a window seat. And if you ask a question, what is your window seat? Somebody says, a delivery manager. What is your window seat? An executive vice president. What is your window seat? No, I know I want a window seat, but I don't know what that is. And you ask another person, what is your window seat? I want to become an architect. So in order to capture the window seat, from the time your onboarding starts, you graduate out of a college, onboarding starts. From that time, in each and every step, they are fast. They're very fast. They don't understand their opportunities to learn things. They don't write beautiful code. They don't do software engineering very well with high quality because they are in a mad rush to occupy the window seat. Sometimes you are in a mad rush, you go and realize that there's no window seat. There's nothing like that. Sometimes you go and occupy, later you feel that you are incompetent. You are not ready to talk about it. You're either a PowerPoint architect or you are a relay sport architect. And if we want to reverse this trend, going agile is the way. When agile teams work together, and assuming that you have the right architect in your team, he is not a relay sport architect. He's going to sit with the team throughout the project, imagine. So those young engineers who have boarded into your company from a university, they are going to go through a great experience. They're going to write beautiful code. They're going to understand what architecture is. And whether they are in a mad rush to occupy the window seat or not, in each and every step, they are going to gain good experience. How many of you agree? Raise your hands. So, don't we have to give that experience to our team members, those young kids who graduate from college and come into our companies? We should. So with that note, this is, go ahead. Yes, yes. Yeah, that can be a value add. Yeah. If you are able to come up with a system like this. See, for example, there are software systems or products that live for more than 10 years. They undergo upgrades, they are upgraded on operating systems and databases, but the life is more than 10 years. So imagine that you have a system like this. Let me extend it beyond imagination. Assume that you are sitting in your office bus, and a production support bug pops up. Immediately you are able to go to a smartphone application. It helps you browse through the map of your architecture and arrive at a location where the enhancement has to be made. You're going to reach the office and swipe your card in a different mindset. You want to do it, you want to satisfy the customer. Now, as soon as you receive a mail like that, what happens? Your blood boils. The temperature in your body increases because you don't know where the bug is. You don't know whether you're going to solve it before 5 o'clock that day, and your son or daughter's birthday is that day, or your spouse's birthday. You have to go home on time. There's no guarantee. And that puts a lot of stress on IT professionals. Yeah, that's a good point. We should, that is a, that can be a valid point. Yes, thank you. So now, sometimes, yeah, go ahead.
Justify the ROI, meaning, you know, typically, like you said, you know, architects are senior people, they are, you know, from a cost perspective, they are expensive.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, from an ROI perspective, if we have more number of architects in the company, that, you know, every small team has an architect engaged all the way through, you know, the project execution. You think, you know, from this perspective of cost, is it justified or is there a way to model it differently?
It is justified. See, assume that we have a we have an international swimming pool, which meets all these international standards. A lot of young kids in Pune come and learn swimming there. And there are these five lifesavers. They come, they're well dressed, they sit there, and they're listening to Radio Mirchi every day. And whenever they see somebody drowning, they would go and help and come back. So their activity is done. And this happens only once or twice in a year. So you never know the other three guys are efficient or effective. You convert all of them as trainers. You want to save people's life, and you're also going to be in the pool all the time. You're going to train these young kids. So now apply this to a software project. Instead of having those architects who sit in a cabin in closed doors, put them on the ground. So that will either help you eliminate bad architects, or that will help us cultivate the architecture culture in teams. That will nurture those skills and competence in teams. Otherwise, I think any software professionals with certain number of years of experience can get into a project and find faults. Sometimes those faults may be false positives, or they may be real defects. Shortcomings. If we want to utilize architects, the real ROI happens when architects work with the team and motivate the team. So you cannot equate an architect's hour with money. You cannot say that this architect is worth $200 an hour. How do you know? What kind of deliverable these architects have delivered to the organization? And how do you estimate that ROI based on a knowledge which that has not been proved? Just because somebody has 20 years experience, you cannot put a dollar rate or hourly rate on the person. You understand my point of view? And or go by facts. Tell that last year this architect got me this much revenue. So with that ROI, I want to compare what I'm going to do now. So do we have any numbers to compare? In most cases, we don't. We go with assumptions. And those are dire, dangerous, disastrous assumptions. That's how I would put it. Because we talk about ROI, we ask questions, what value do you bring onto the table? Just get onto the ground, work. And in that process, let these young engineers learn from you. Let them learn what design is. Because by sending somebody for a two-day training program on design, I don't think they're going to become better designers. They will know what design is all about. They will know something about design. Then they have to go through a whole lot of process. They have to read a lot, they have to experiment a lot, they have to do a lot of hands-on activities. And when there is a senior person who is capable of doing it, whatever, maybe somebody who does a lot of design but he's not doing so much of coding, that's okay. If team members can learn design from this person, why not? And in that process, is this architect ready to learn coding from the team? Or has this person's kind of living with the mindset that coding is all over in my life? I'm going to be a block diagram person. I'm going to create those diagrams and continue. pre-sales person, not a delivery person. You can go and market things, you can go and sell things. You cannot implement, you cannot deliver. So to deliver, I don't think we need block that. And again, a lot of questions come. Hey, in what kind of project we need to focus considerable time on defining and implementing architecture and designs, and in what kind of projects we need not. We can go quickly and implement features. So this is a schematic I came up with. See, there are four factors, four key factors. Yes?
I guess the return of investments should be linked to the amount of cost savings that we would be making in the maintenance of the project.
See, return of, if you go by financial terms, right? If you look at only money as a measure, the return of investment concept is very clear. It's very simple. Whatever you invest, what return you're getting. But what are the byproducts? I can increase my return on investment by keep on working on projects. And after 5 years, what is going to happen to my health, to my family? What kind of competencies am I developing? Am I developing myself? These are important. When you work as software teams, when you have a senior person who calls himself a designer or an architect, more than the monetary return of value is important. More than that, how is the team getting motivated with this person? What kind of learnings are they getting? Is he creating new designers? Is he creating new architects? Or always we have the worry that, hey, those 5 guys are the architects, what will happen if these 3 guys design? Who is going to be the next? Are we creating the next level of people in the company? So we have to see all this together and see if the ROI is justified or not. Because if for certain kind of activities, we cannot have a direct measure of ROI. For example, I'm coming and speaking here, my company says, what is the ROI of Raja going and spending half day in a hotel in Pune? I don't have an answer. You want, I will go and talk. If you don't want, I'm not going to go and talk. But this is a community event. We are learning so many things. Similarly, an architect believes that yes, he has certain things to do to his team in terms of increasing their experience or competency or improving the quality of product, that itself is valuable. It is going to improve
the
output.
The maintenance cycle would be less, right?
Yes, yeah, that is where, yeah, internal cycle.
That's measure on that.
Yes,
yes.
If
you do it wrong, then you'll be spending a huge amount of dollars fixing that network.
Yes. So it is good to compare, ask a question, what is the current ROI? And what ROI are we expecting next year and demonstrate? And we don't know the current ROI. And when somebody asks a question, it's like you're getting a nightmare and getting out of your bed and your throat is all warmed up, you want to drink some water. I may be a little critical, but it's true. That is what is the question. So I came up with these key factors. There are 4 key factors I've identified. There may be some more also. One is the primary thing is the competency, architecture and design competency of the set of people who perform that activity. You may have an expert, you may have a novice who doesn't know. And technology, what kind of technology is involved in your project? Whether the technology stack is familiar to this team or it is totally a new stack. Next is domain. What kind of domain are they working on? What domain is this project all about? Is it familiar domain or unfamiliar domain? And complexity. For example, is it a massive complex project, several interfaces and stuff, or it's a simple project? Let us take that side, the hello side. Assume that the CIO of a company wants to implement a timesheet management system or an attendance management system. And all of you sit in a meeting and the project manager or one of the senior members, the so-called designer or architect, say, you know what, we need at least a month to define and construct the architecture components.
CIO is going to wonder, hey, what are you guys doing? I want this system in 3 weeks. I cannot wait for a month. So assuming that company has defined platforms, defined technology to develop their applications, smart architects will go and reuse existing components. They are not going to write new exception handlers. They are not going to write new logging frameworks. They are going to reuse existing things. They are going to work on features because they want to show how the system works to the stakeholders early. So they can start implementing features as early. Right? Whereas if you are on this side, sorry, I think I switched. So I talked about the green side. Let me now move on to the yellow side, where things are fuzzy. You are asked to define and create an exchange, traders exchange, for commodity trading across countries. So this is a new domain. And it is going to involve multiple technologies, it is going to involve people from multiple countries, then it is worth doing a good number of meetings and decision making on your architecture and design. It is good to prototype architecture. If you desire a certain set of combinations, an operating system, database, application server and stuff, it is good to take some prominent use cases or user stories, implement them and see if the architecture can hold those features, and even you have to demonstrate it. Because it's not like the typical city development in a city like Pune. So city planning sits in somebody's office. But all you see is a narrow road that gets developed, and a lot of apartments are surrounding that. And all of a sudden, what happens? Plumbing across the road. And after a few years, road widening happens. Nobody was aware that the road was going to be that broad. And all of a sudden, the road is broad. So these kind of implementations or approaches in software will create a big mess. You should think through. You should have, at the same time, you cannot afford to do big upfront design. I don't mean a big upfront design. You should take certain decisions. You have to think about certain things which are very, very necessary, and move on to implementing things so that you get an opportunity to identify risks ahead of them. Okay? And so which means that even if pure agile methods say that, you know what, from the first iteration start delivering features, that doesn't work in practice. You have to fit your method to the project. You cannot fit your project into the method. So whatever, depending on the nature of your project, depending on the circumstances, depending on the competency, technology, domain, and project complexity, and factors like this, you have to take a call. Agile doesn't say that there is no thing called an architecture sprint. You can do that. You can start with an architecture sprint, spend one or two sprints or one or two iterations. And if you want to spend one full iteration only in testing, you do that. Because that is your way of doing things. If it makes sense to you, do that. And that is going to happen. So with that concluding remarks, thank you. Any questions? So this is my last slide. Yes?
From your point of view, what do you think should be ideal org structure in which an architect
should design? Org structure in which an architect? Yeah. See, an architect, as I told you, there are several types of architects. And these days you hear about enterprise architects who are responsible for defining and maintaining the architecture at enterprise level. But you consider a project. A software architect who works in a software project, he belongs to that organization. And ideally, taking positions doesn't work. That's what agile methods are all about. For example, Scrum says there is a Scrum Master who is more like a coach, an enabler, a facilitator, but not a manager. And with the Scrum Master, the Scrum team works. A Scrum team is typically 7 to 10 people, or 7 to 9 people. And all of them are called team members. And they work as a team. So an architect has to fit into that structure. Whereas DSDM, which is another agile method, talks about technical leads, a role called tech lead,
role called architect, these are absolutely fine. But whenever you define such role, you have to ask yourself, what do these guys bring onto the table? What are their deliverables?
But fitting into a scrum team restricts his jurisdiction, right? You would expect him to work across teams in a project.
Should you or shouldn't you? That is the question. So what, it depends on the, see, structure is one thing, but behavior is important. What kind of behavior do you expect from an architect? Do you think that an architect working with that team until the end of the project is going to give you better results? Then why would you like him to work on different projects?
I didn't say different projects. I said different teams on the same project.
That is absolutely fine. If a big project is happening, it has multiple scrum teams, there can be an architect who interfaces with all teams. And he makes valuable deliverables. He should not be an authoritarian who just say, you know what, do what I say. Or ask questions like, why did you change the design without my permission? So he should create an open environment and avoid hierarchy. He should be an enabler.
I'm trying to be a little more specific. Would an architect typically report into a dev manager? Would he report into a dev director who looks after different dev managers? Should he be aligned with the development team hierarchy? Should he be aligned with the business team hierarchy? Just because typically in a big organization, you often have matrix environments, right? So that's why I asked this question. Because this influences how accountable an architect is to the success of the project.
See, depending on the expectations of the project from that architect, you have to design the reporting structure. In an ongoing basis, he may be reporting into a functional head or the CTO, etc. That's fine. But as soon as he is allocated to a large project which has multiple scrum teams and he is responsible for working with all these teams and delivering, there has to be a commitment that, okay, he is a full-time architect on this project. And he will report into someone who is owning this project on behalf of this organization. That can be your chief scrum master, or that can be your delivery head, or whoever it is. Because I think we spend more time in thinking about these reporting structures and authorities and hierarchies than thinking about how we can do things better. That is going to continue anyway, but it is going to pass at regular intervals and think about that also. That will make our lives better. That is what I believe. We should do that. That will make some difference. If we keep on thinking about, these are important things. We live in a corporate life. We cannot ignore these reporting structures. We cannot ignore these hierarchies. Yes.
Prior to the start of your sprint one,
yes.
Okay, you have a sprint zero where, so in sprint zero, like what role the architecture or designer should play, where your conceptual design is in the process.
Mm-hmm.
So what kind of inputs should be given to the team so that the teams actually get started on the sprint first, prior to your development started?
See, sprint zero, of the first 2 or 3 weeks, or 1 month you spend in a project, is about understanding the project. What are the high level needs of the project? And who are the customers? And on what kind of platform is this project is going to work on? The hardware, software platforms, and the versions of the software tools and packages you're going to use. The development environment that you're going to use. Configuration management system you want to use, and various other tools that are going to enable your team, like a bug tracking tool or an agile project management tool that you're going to use. All these decisions are important. After that, how this system is going to get implemented at the end? How many later appraisal remarks at the end? But you should create the vision in the team. The team members should know, oh, this is what we are going to do. It has to be a team exercise. And keep doing those iteration after iteration. So that is where you are restraining yourself from big upfront design.
and you're doing minimalistic design, minimalistic definition, you are developing features, and you create an opportunity to fail early or fail fast. When you fail early and fail fast, you also have an opportunity to improve yourself fast and do things better. So if you want to read a descriptive thing about what I'm telling you, I've written there's a PDF called Critical Success Factors in Distributed Agile. So if you search Critical Success Factors and my name, probably that PDF should come on Google. Download the PDF, read it. I think I've elaborated in a section called the base camp. So we call it the base camp. When you start a project, you have to have a base camp. That is, before starting your trekking on complex mountains, you do a base camp. And all people come together, they understand what they're going to do, who is going in which direction, and what time they're going to come back and meet again. So base camp or sprint zero is very essential. And you should have a clarity on what you're going to do in sprint zero. Otherwise, you complete all days in sprint zero, you remain clueless. And that's not good. Good question. I think you're running out of time, or we have time? Okay.
Yes,
sir. Hi, Yadish.
Actually, I have a question on the balance of this upfront design and the problems that we face post, implementation of the system. So since we, Agile, don't recommend this upfront design, what happens, as and how we progress, we figure out that, we should have structured this class structure or something, well in advance, and it could have helped, to follow some standard guidelines. So since we don't do that, we end up having some code which is not aligned with the, or which is not uniform for the project, and we end up doing refactoring or, so there is, and also we get into maintenance problem. So yeah. What is your, suggestion on balancing this,
See, that is what you realize. Right? When you have a steady and joyful journey towards the window seat, you're not rushing on each and every step. You pause, you reflect, you learn. And can you do a project without all these mistakes? The answer is no. But when you reflect and learn, you can do course correction. You can do things in a better way. Whatever you're told, I think it's a good learning for all of us. And we have done that in practice. Maybe next time you're going to think about it. You're going to ask a question, are we ignoring something in sprint zero? Or are we ignoring something in this base camp? Do you think we have to develop one more critical component and make sure that it works? If yes, what is that? Can you identify the critical component? So these dialogues will happen in meetings. We will not blindly follow somebody. But can we do a project spick and span from day one to day end and deliver? I don't think Shaniwar Wada or Taj Mahal was built that way. And forget about historic monuments. Even some of the cool things like iPad and all these devices, I don't think they were constructed that way. You always do the backtracking. You do something, you find that it can be done better, you backtrack. And you move towards the finished product. Happen. Design can change, people can forget, or people can take wrong decisions. But agile teams value people. They are accommodative. They learn and move forward. They don't start the blame game and stop the show. It can happen, yes.
Oh, we have time for one last question.
Hi, Moni. This is Vaishali Rakhi. I have seen, even enterprise architects would, whenever they are planning for a solution, they would think of either, from the technology point of view, but very few people think of business model, because these are the dynamic things in business. And a same industry or a same a kind of a typical kind of thing would follow different business model. So how does one take care of that? Because teams are typically focused on, a very specific aspect of the solution or the product. And to bring in that kind of thinking and the discipline into the team to think about the business model of the customer?
See, understanding the business requirement of the customer is very important. So there itself many teams falter or fail. Participating in discussions, asking questions, and showing working features to the customer, getting their feedback. So these are the activities where you are going to get more and more response from the business users. So when you interact more and more with business users and you have open mind to learn business, you are going to learn more about business requirements. And the next stage is understanding their business model, how the business model works, who are the competitors, in what way this software application or product is going to make sense to their business, in what way it is going to help them meet their business goals, who are their peers or growing competitors. So these kind of questions have to be asked. It cannot be asked by junior engineers. So these questions have to be asked by some of the senior folks in the team